are so great for doing that. You needed a little stretch, didn't you? You needed to get limber after all that good Filipino food.
Yeah.
Yes, did you like that food?
Yeah.
I believe it's from North Star, Northern Star, yes? Yes? Northern?
North Star.
North Star. You should all support Filipino American businesses. It's very, very important to do.
Yeah.
All right. So, in the language of my parents, my immigrant Pinoy parents, magandang umaga sa inyong lahat. In the language of my hometown of Seattle or Sheffield, Washington, good morning to you all. And in the language of my old neighborhood in Detroit, what's up? How y'all doing today? What up, though? You see, when you walk down the streets of Motown, you've got to talk to people or they'll talk about you. So I feel so thankful to have been able to make it here today because I have been ill, I've been out of commission, and just really starting to feel like myself again. And I want to first give a big maraming salama, many thanks to all of you for being here on this beautiful Saturday afternoon. I mean, 67 degrees in February for this gala, celebrating 10 years of the Filipino American Studies class here at the University of Maryland College Park.
Yeah.
10 years. Yeah, give it up for
you. Yeah.
My mentor, Ninong, and uncle, the late Dr. Fred Cordova, taught me to say thank you before it is too late. So bear with me. Maraming salama. Thank you so much to the board members of the Filipino Cultural Association for inviting me to keynote this special occasion, especially President Alexis Flores for her hard work. Yes, give it up for Alexis. You see her in her long hair? Yes. Her hard work arranging everything, as well as the board members Danny Chang and AJ Rivera for driving me around. Justin, Josh, and Eric for joining them and taking me to eat at the wonderful restaurant Purple Patch. Yes, ma'am. If you have never been to Purple Patch, you need to go there. It's in the Mount Pleasant neighborhood of Washington, D.C., and please tell their second generation Pinay owner, Patrice Cleary, that we sent you, okay? Special thanks to the student government for funding my trip here, and to my kasama, your professor, Jem Douse, for recommending me. Give it up for Jem. Jem Aral. Teaching your Filipino American Studies class here for the last 10 years.
Yeah.
I feel very, very honored and blessed, just blessed to be back in the Washington, D.C. area. The first time I visited D.C. was as a teen with the Filipino Youth Activities Drill Team, pictured here, which was founded by 16 families in Seattle in 1959 and still in existence. We toured and stayed with some of you, with Filipino American families here in D.C., in Oxon Hill, Spring. Yeah, who's from Oxon Hill here? Oxon Hill. Yeah, shout out to Oxon Hill. In Silver Springs, I stayed with the judge, with the Valderramas here in, where was that, Alexandria? I forgot what their city. And we also stayed in Norfolk, and Virginia Beach. Thanks to my sister friend Edwina Lava Bergogno and my brother friend Dr. Alan Bergogno, who drove all the way from Virginia Beach to be here today. So give it up for the Bergognos there. For those of you who don't know, Dr. Bregano was actually the first Filipino-American dentist to practice in Virginia Beach, and I want to congratulate them on winning their recent lawsuit against the city that tried to displace their practice through eminent domain. But they won. Congratulations. This last week, they won their suit. Alan and Edwina were actually the ones who introduced me to this my East Coast contemporaries here. Those who were the founders of FIND. I know you all are members of the Filipino Intercollegiate Networking Dialogue. And yes, and those who are still active. They are actually still active in the DC politics and in community organizations. And so today, I actually dedicate this to the memory of one of our Kasamas, who passed away last year, Joe Montano, who's right here. Yeah, did you all know Joe? You should have known Joe. Joe Montano, who was very much an advocate for Filipino-American studies, Filipino-American history, and the struggle to recognize Filipino-American veterans. And when we were here we are actually at the FONS office in Seattle many, many years ago with our other mentors, the late Uncle Bob Santos, who passed away last year also, and Uncle Fred, and Auntie Dorothy Cordova, who is the founder and non-paid executive director of our historical society. And Ray Obispo, maybe some of you had him as a teacher at Salem High School in Virginia Beach, too. So I want to also acknowledge my sister Carmelita Floresca Bridges, who drove all the way from Fredericksburg with her husband Jerry and their son Leandro, who actually Leandro is named after his late grandfather, Leandro Marzan Floresca, pictured here, who was a veteran in the first Filipino infantry regiment of the United States Army during World War II. So it is fitting that they be here today with Major General Antonio Taguba in attendance as well. And our Kasama, Ben de Guzman, right? Both of whom, with all of you, have really participated in organizing in the last 20 years for benefits for Filipino American veterans, and today for recognizing them for the Congressional Gold Medal. Here we go. Here are some. Yeah, you can give it up for them. Yeah, absolutely. From the Central District at the south end of Seattle.
Where?
There were a lot of black folks, Jewish folks, so that meant there were a lot of churches. So if you feel like church up in here today, absolutely say, go ahead, amen, clap. You won't throw me off, believe me. Okay? So if you want to tweet our history up here, you can also tweet it, you can Facebook Live, and you can do whatever you want, and it'll all be good. So yes. Yes, thank you. Okay, so I'm going to tell you some of our family history, our history here, because it is important as Filipino Americans, in order to know where we're going, we must know and acknowledge where we come from and those who've gone before. Since I'm an oral historian and spoken word performance poet, I'd like to begin with an excerpt from a poem. It's a poem that I wrote on the unveiling of the Aloha Grocery mural. Oh, okay. You'll hear about them in a minute. On the Aloha Grocery Mural, which was designed by my friends Tony Asumi and Jenny Kuita. They designed the mural with the help of the community around the Aloha Grocery on Centinela Avenue in Los Angeles. Are any of you from LA? Okay, yay! All right. They also helped design murals in Detroit, with Detroit Summer, which I used to volunteer with as well. So some of you may have known that I met my husband, Professor Scott Kurashige, when we were classmates in graduate school at UCLA. He is a fourth generation Japanese American, and I am a second generation Pinay. And now every year, we both teach hundreds of students, and we found that this is the history that we share. The love of my life brought me to this spot before I even had a clue that he liked me. We were classmates, and it was my first summer in Los Angeles. We had just after a year of stale dorm food at UCLA. We walked past the old Manila salon where he used to get his hair cut by his old neighbor, and he took me next door to Filipinas Training Center just to prove that he was cool, where I loaded up on newspapers and sweet halo halo mix for shaved ice. And after buying a truckload of pan de leche, arare, and macadamia nut cookies, we drove down Cincinnati Avenue past the Venice Japanese Community Center, where he played basketball since he was 5, and the Buddhist temple, where he still holds the best record for Sunday school attendance. You couldn't guess that now, no way, and neither did I back then, but it's only befitting for the grandson of the head minister of the Buddhist Church of Seattle, my hometown. And as we drove and munched on senbei, then we found this is the history that we share. How his father hails from Kona Farms, much like the ones that once bore fruit here. How my uncles, my aunties, manongs and manongs toiled this land when it was celery and lettuce. How his paternal grandparents fanned the cane fires and plantation strikes of Hawaii, while my migrant uncles, with hundreds of Chicano braceros, walked picket lines in Yakima, Watsonville, Delano, Stockton, and here. And how his auntie cleaned houses and my mother sewed garments, both for mere cents per hour. How my father, my godfather, Urbano Quijance, my uncle, Eddie Espanol, uncle, Leandro Floresca, uncle, Johnny Ordonia, and uncle, Paul Amaral, served in the U.S. Army's Filipino infantry regiments and MacArthur's Philippine scouts, fighting for this country's freedom in their homeland of Bataan, Corregidor, and Leyte. While my husband's mother, his grandmother, his Uncle Sat, Auntie X, Uncle Kaz, Uncle Aki, Auntie Hiro, and Uncle Shinya lost their freedom behind barbed wire in two of America's concentration camps, Minidoka and Crystal City, a camp for possible high-risk evacuees, where they joined his grandfather much, much later. The elder's grandfather's risk or crime, being a devout, peaceful minister. See, this is our history that we share. And over 50 years later, the real crime is that his grandfather never lived to see an apology or reparations. We kept on driving, and we keep on driving. And when we returned to campus, we learned more from our talk story than any stack of textbooks could ever tell. See, this is the history we continue to share. This is our history that we must continue to share. This is our history that we all share.
Yeah.
Thank you. Find that poem buried somewhere on the Great Leap website. I share this poem with you not only because I'm an oral historian and performance poet, but to show you how many commonalities we all really do share. If you haven't done so already, well, actually, let me get a show of hands. How many of y'all ever interviewed your family, your mother, your father? Raise your hand. Good. Good for you. And we want to see those. We want to see those published. We want to see those shared. Donate them to our archives or the Rita Caucus archives here that you're so generous and so blessed to be able to have here. If you haven't done so already, I urge you to learn your own family and community's history before it is too late. Because as you go off into the world, whether it's for graduate school or family or work, you will be expected to learn all sorts of facts and figures, and hopefully some of it will be useful to you in your life. But some of it may not be. And with that in mind, I ask you, how can you expect to learn other people's history if you don't even know your own? You know what I'm saying? Yeah, that's right. And as painful as it may be, talk to your grandparents, your parents, your uncles, your aunties, and learn that history so we can share it, so you can share it. Start today. Start here. You got your phones? They record real easy these days. It's so much easier now. You just press play, record. In life, you have choices with what you can do with your time, your education, and your energy. Choose to follow your heart, because this is the history that we share. 48 years ago, actually probably more than 48 now, it's 49. 49 years ago, in 1968, Asian American and other students of color staged strikes and sit-ins at colleges and universities, demanding ethnic studies, open enrollment, self-determination, and a relevant education for all. As a result, we now have more students of color and ethnic studies classes like those that I am privileged to teach. You have a flourishing Asian American Studies program here. And I want to recognize your director, Janelle Wong, in the back. As our strength to push forward what is right not only for Filipinos, but for all people. See, this is the history that we share. At many colleges and universities throughout the country, Asian Americans are privileged. You are privileged to have the largest numbers among minority students' enrollment. However, that doesn't mean that we are shielded from racism or discrimination. And even if we are, that does not mean that we must ignore those who are not as privileged as we, Asians and non-Asians. Black lives do matter. We must all recognize the privilege of being able to go to school and accomplish what we're able to do thanks to our ancestors, those students and workers who literally, literally plowed these fields before us. This past June, I'm going to show you these first. Today is a very monumental day. Very monumental day. You know, you get those on Facebook on this day. Y'all should take a picture of this so it keeps coming back up in your Facebook feed and you'll be reminded. On this day in 1946, President Harry Truman signed the Rescission Act. The Rescission Act, rescinding the recognition of Filipinos like my uncles, like my father, who served in the guerrillas, who served this country in World War II. And so today it's very fitting that we're actually raising funds. Thank you for donating your ticket and your money to raise funds to recognize these veterans, not only through the Taguba Scholarship Fund, but for the Congressional Gold Medal as well.
Yeah.
That's right.
That's right.
And I know General Taguba is going to tell you more about that, so I won't steal his thunder. And tomorrow, February 19th, this is why I also read you that poem. February 19th, 1942, President Franklin D. Roosevelt signed Executive Order 9066. Okay, your president now has been signing all these executive orders. Well, those of us in Asian American studies, those of us with Japanese American families, we get nervous. We get nervous when we hear executive order. Because we know what executive orders can do. They can lock our families up like they locked up my husband's family, okay? In the mass incarceration of over 120,000 Japanese Americans during World War II in concentration camps across America. And if you don't know this history, you should. You should, you should, you should, because this is the history that we share. Tomorrow they're actually showing the film Allegiance to commemorate the Day of Remembrance in different cities across the country at 12:55 p.m. if you're interested in seeing those. It's important to know this history, because how many of you have ever been asked, where are you from? If you haven't, most of you who are going to go to school or the workplace can tell you that sooner or later, that you'll be asked that 1,000 times. I'm asked that every day. And our activist and scholar friend Vijay Prashad says that when they ask you, where are you from, they're really asking you, when the hell are you going back? And you need to have the skills and the wisdom to know when to say, I'm not going back. I'm staying here. I'm showing up. And I'm giving back to my community here. See, this is the history that we share. This is the history that we must share. I'm sure the committee today will tell you how today's festivities came about. What bears repeating, though, is that this gala was not meant to just promote individualism or elitism. On the contrary, events like these are founded on the principle of reaching and fostering community, reaching and giving back to our ancestors through our community. The late Carlos Bulacan, Filipino novelist and poet, once wrote, "History has determined our lives, and we must do what's right for the Filipino people. Life is something we borrow, and we must give back richer when the time comes. Mm. Whether you or we like to admit it or not, that time is coming sooner than you think. For some, that time is now. See, this is the history that you must continue to share. So as you go off to the world using your good skills, bring them back. Give them back to the community. All of you are FCA and FIND family, right? So that makes you part of our FONS familia, our Filipino-American National Historical Society familia. All of you, we need you to continue to grow and continue to be our leaders, our movers, our shakers. This past June, Jem, Alan, Edwina, Ben, General Taguba, and I, along with 700 other scholars, students, activists, artists, community workers, and just plain good old folk from all over the country, descended onto New York City for the Filipino-American National Historical Society's National Conference. There we addressed the history of Filipinos in the U.S. since the year 1587, when the first Spanish galleon landed on the shores of Morro Bay, California. It is why we commemorate October as Filipino-American History Month, and we hope that many of you will join us at the next FONS conference in Chicago in 2018 and Hilo, Hawaii in 2020, because this is the history that we share. We live under a new world order now. Many of our civil liberties have been and can be even more so taken away. We must stand together to protect not only ourselves, but our brown and black brothers and sisters who are even more vulnerable. We must not forget that this is the history that we all share. And we can't all be activists or university professors, but I don't think you may want to be that, or performers even, but we all can be humanitarians, sharing our wealth, both financially and through service. One of my mentors from UCLA, the late Uncle Roy Morales, used to say, you can give one or all of the three treasures, the three T's, you know, not TT, but T's, three T's, your time, your talent, and or your treasure. We can continue to be bearers of our culture, sharing the centuries of history of our legacy on this continent, because this is the history that we must share. As anti-martial law and Filipino-American civil rights activists taught us more than 40 years ago, makibaka, wag magtako, fight the struggle, have no fear, have no fear. Peace and maraming salamat po. Thank you very much.
Yeah, oh! Oh!
Another round of applause for that amazing. At this moment, we will take another quick break. And as a reminder, we have the donation table back in front near the exit.
Emily knocked it out. $3
to $5. $3 to $5.